Wesley Stuckey is our speaker for color this morning. I'm really excited to have Wesley. So Wesley is a graphic designer and illustrator based in Baltimore. He's originally from Mississippi, so you will immediately discover that as he begins to speak, and a little bit of Southern twang comes out, and it's real nice. And it's very, very charming. The first time I met him, my sort of heart opened to him. He is a graduate of MICA and has a Master's of Fine Arts in Graphic Design. You'll see his work around town. He did the new design for Belvedere, which I feel like totally rejuvenated their branding, and it looks just gorgeous, and like the details of that design and that branding is really, really lovely. You also see his work at Doobie's if you've ever been there before, and there's that giant wall with all the little illustrations on it. That's Wesley's work. You'll also notice Wesley's work every time you come to Creative Mornings, and you'll see these little postcards of these lovely little charming illustrations of the food. That is Wesley's work. He also has done design for Tatley. When I asked Wesley this morning, like, how would you describe Tatley, like, really briefly? He said, it's temporary tattoos that are awesome. That's basically it. So, yeah, they're super cool temporary tattoos, and I have some to give away later. To give away this way. This is gonna be really exciting for you guys. It's like Oprah, but more white. I don't know. So currently, Wesley does freelance design. You can find him at wesleystuckey.com. But he also teaches. He teaches at MICA and then also at UMBC, branding and typography. Thank you. I got to do a studio visit with Wesley once, and I found it so inspiring and really exciting to see the way that he sort of crafted his space. And I think that I got a real sort of window into how seriously he takes his craft, how much time he puts into the space in which the craft is happening. Everything is very intricate, everything is very organized, everything is very well put together, and everything has purpose. Every part of his studio is a piece of inspiration, and it's sort of this place of discovery. So I'm thrilled to hear what he has to say about this theme of color, which is really just sort of fun and joyful theme, in part because I know that this is a place of discovery for him also, and for him to share that with us. So with no further ado, Wesley, but first, we have Shine Creative is really, really just like brilliant in that they got bored with, like, we don't want to just do like B-rolls of people drinking coffee every time. So how can we like actually inject this with some amazingness? So they did a preview video with Wesley a couple weeks ago. They did a shoot with him in his studio and put together this short film, which is really lovely. And so you'll get sort of a more visual insight and better introduction than I just gave to Wesley. So here you go. He'll take the mic after that. I swear I'm done.
I find color to be a very personal thing. I grew up in rural South Mississippi. When I think of red and green, I don't think of Christmas as much. I think more of watermelon. And I think being in the middle of a watermelon field with, you know, all this green lush vines and, you know, being hot and just taking a watermelon, crushing it on the ground, all of a sudden you have this sea of red. I have a strong background in printmaking and print design. So I always think about the use of color as a storytelling mechanism. So I designed the little note cards for each of the Creative Mornings talks. Today we're having apple cider donuts. Because I'm thinking in separations for color, I'm just gonna paint the body of an apple, and then on a separate sheet I'll draw the stem. It took me years to figure out that black really is the most important thing in a designer's palette. With black, everything's possible because then you're just focusing on the shape or the content. You're not focusing on the details. My favorite color is black. It's the thing that locks everything together. It's kind of like the jewelry on a wonderful red carpet affair. I get an email from Katie or a text message saying, hey, this month we're doing blank for, you know, food. I'm like, okay, cool. And then I have to figure out how to make that work. I'm just gonna lay them on the scanner bed. What I need to do is select each shape and cut it out of here. Cut this leaf out, then this is the veins of the leaf. It's like putting together like Legos or something. So now I can go pop, 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 pop. And here, because they're bitmaps, now I can apply a color. I embody the fact that I'm printing on an uncoated paper with inkjet, you know, ink. So I really try to make my colors purposely desaturated or a little bit more muted to appeal to that print. I might duplicate the cider and give it like an offset stroke to give it a little bit more emphasis with rainbow sprinkles. It's too round, it's too wide. So if I change it to den, den's a little bit more condensed, a little bit more vertical. So this is pretty much how it happened. Apple cider donuts with rainbow sprinkles. So, color. When I was chatting with Katie and the rest of the team a couple months ago about what we should be doing for color, I kept thinking, you know, there's many things you could do. Color is such a very personal thing. Slides. It's one of those things that I find really intriguing as a designer. We never know really how people interpret color. What I see as a color, you may not see as the same. So for instance, this image. Last summer, I was lucky enough to be at Versailles, and I was really taken by all of the greenery in the gardens and how these white urns and benches just really, you know, stand out in contrast. But I wanted to look at it a little bit more intensely and think about it. Most people just see this as green. It's just, you know, a wall of plants, but there we go. So I dropped in Photoshop 20 different shades of green that are from that one photograph, from one moment in a garden. And every single one of these are slightly different. Some are more yellow, some are more blue, some are more red. I had a professor in undergrad at Mississippi State University that used to tell me, don't call colors green or purple or orange. Everything's a shade of red, yellow, and blue. It's more red, it's more yellow, or it's more blue. And so thinking about that, that kind of shaped how I think about color. And so if you just go back to the same image and you start thinking about each of those moments, you know, some of these leaves are actually yellow. They're almost, you know, not green at all. And so it really is interesting to see how nature has this palette of colors that's just overwhelming. Kind of like my favorite, which, by the way, Jim Henson is from Mississippi, so little connection.
Having to spend each day the color of the leaves. When I think it could be nicer being red or yellow or gold or something much more colorful like that. It's not that easy being green.
Sometimes I think he's just talking about me.
It seems you blend in with so many other ordinary things.
I love that the simple fact of just even the color palette of Kermit, his red mouth really vibrates against his felt, his tongue is actually pink, and it kind of really, it accentuates things so perfectly. So even though it's not easy being green, it's beautiful. So that leads me to the next. For me, color is very nostalgic. There's moments that we all have in our past, in our history, that you remember a color because of a certain time period or because of something that happened in your life and that kind of resonates with you. So I remember being a kid and watching Dorothy and the Wizard of Oz, and I remember just personally how important this was, but as I've gotten older and started learning more about design and color, it's even more important because this is one of the first chances for Technicolor to really take the screen. And it became an instant vocabulary that we all know. This moment that Dorothy opens this door and lands in Oz, we all immediately know that blue gingham and ruby red slippers and a yellow brick road and Emerald City, those are all things that are iconic to a period in time, is iconic to our childhood, and it's just so glossy and so beautiful. And think about how shocking this was when it happened. It's such a different world from seeing everything in black and white. Even though black's my favorite, I think, color can really just make things wow. Kind of like she's experiencing for the first time. And then as the movie progressed and you get through the storyline and she gets through the forest and she lands upon this field of poppies, they really embrace the fact that it's color that we're seeing. And for the first time, we can see a whole field of this red that's just like the sea of watermelons that I remember from my childhood. It's breathtaking. I could just imagine walking into this field and being overwhelmed. And then, if that's not good enough, as soon as they reach that field and they look in the distance, that happens. What's better than red? Red and green, because now we have something to compare it against. Without red, you don't know what green is. Without green, we don't know what red is. So it really takes both to complement. So the Emerald City just changed the way that I saw the world. Then there's Running with Scissors. This happened to come out a couple years ago. And while this was about 10 years before I was born, in the stage, it resonated with me because I grew up in a house that had a yellow bathroom that was exactly this yellow, that was from the 70s. And the beauty of how vibrant and how exciting that yellow is. And Deirdre, Augustine Burroughs' mother, is so depressed. And so this irony between a color that's so happy and this person that's so depressed. I think that's just brilliant. And the way that even the accents of Augustine's blue, which is kind of melancholy, that juxtaposition, he has hope while she has depression. And I think that resonates with a lot of people. Color is iconic, just as that yellow in that image makes me think about my bathroom when I was growing up. There's things like this. Anybody have a clue what this color actually is?
Jubi's blue.
It's Tiffany's. But if you didn't know this blue on its own, this would help, right? Seeing jewelry as context. And then Tiffany blue. Every bride wishes to have Tiffany, it's like the best. And if you see a little blue box, you know that it's something awesome. It's not gonna be some Cracker Jack jewelry. Then there's this, red. Red in branding is so important because so many things are red. It could be any of these, right? It could be Coke, it could be Netflix, H&M, Macy's, kind of all across the board of high-end and low-end. But if I give you context, now what is it?
Target.
Exactly. So it's not just the red that's important, it's the amount of red, it's the amount of white, it's the things that it pairs with. Target made a name for itself with its branding because of the usage of its red. Then we have this lovely, lovely color. Anybody know what it is? Not quite. It's like retva in Senegal, which occasionally it turns this color for a couple months a year. But it is also Peptol. So it's one of those things, like, it's such an awful pink that you can't ignore it. But it sure does make you feel better when you're sick. Color is how we see things. I can't help but think about, you know, if we didn't think about color, especially in branding, we would be relying entirely on the content. And even then, what makes one clothing company different from another, one coffee house different from another? I identify Doobies because of their blue. So, as Katie mentioned earlier, last October, when Doobies opened in their final location on Charles Street, I was asked to, you know, draw this illustration. Well, I designed it all in blue and black, which are the two colors on their coffee cups. And it just reinforces what their brand is. And it also put my little stamp on it by the type of illustration I made. So in about 2 minutes, you go through what took me 5 days to design. And you know, it was one of those things like painting with a paint marker directly on the wall. It's like the most exciting and rewarding thing I could do. It makes up for all the chances and the times when I got yelled at by my mom for writing on my wall and blaming it on my cat. And my cat didn't even exist at that point. I only had a dog. But to me, my cat did it. I didn't do it because I knew if I did it, I got in trouble. So this is kind of a great opportunity to be a kid again. So I literally, the days that I was in Doobies, I went to the kitchen and got like several of the people there to like just pull knives and different things that were in the kitchen, and I literally drew those things. I also just, you know, found images of, you know, different espresso machines and things that I thought were interesting that would kind of relate to food and coffee. And we're almost done. So if you haven't been to Doobies and seen it, go. Little promotion there. And almost done. And we're done. So color is also extremely important. I took this quote from Wednesday, I think it was Wednesday, the 23rd. Fatal shooting, fatal stabbing in Baltimore City overnight. How horrible of a thing. In all black, we read it as the content. We read the information. Kind of reiterating what I said in the video, you know, we only read the message. If we change that to red, all of a sudden it seems like an emergency. It has more importance. But then what happens if we make it green and kind of a, well, it's supposed to be pink, but the projector makes it a little bit more red. It seems kind of, you know, not important. It seems like, oh, this is just kind of a title. It doesn't make sense. But it's all about the importance of the content. Just as if it's in gray, it's almost like you're whispering it. It's not a headline anymore. It's just kind of there. Color is also unexpected. And I think this is one of the things that as a designer, I really have the privilege and opportunity to play with. This also from Versailles, I wanted to take an image that was pretty classic and straightforward and give it a twist by, you know, making the bust, you know, pale green and pink. And this started working in beautifully with a project of mine for a friend of mine that's a composer, H. Andrew Rieger. So we're launching his website this coming week, and we really wanted to play with this kind of what he considers neo-Baroque, kind of like this idea of etchings and over-the-top decadence, but also in a modern way. And unexpected little things like animations, like the rat running down the stairs, or Marie Antoinette having a dove flying out of her chest, you know? So in every single page, I really want to play with color. This damask wallpaper slowly pulsates with the music. So it changes from being more dominantly pink to more yellow. The idea of a harpsichord and a monkey is completely ridiculous. But it's wonderful because it's so ridiculous. So all of the music that is orchestral has this kind of pink and yellow tone. All the things that are more chamber music, more, you know, solos and just a couple of musicians have this pale green. And it's a way to like divide things, divide information. Pinks being for, you know, orchestral, green for chamber. And on the homepage, you just kind of see it all together. And then things like this, you know, gorgeous, you know, gilded clock, you know, having this really pungent green mixed with gilding. Gilding is such a luxury. And when I think of, you know, gilded, you know, ceilings and walls, you know, much like the set here for Amadeus, it's luxury. It's not, you know, the common person. It's more about, you know, experiencing a moment of what it is to have wealth. And gold does that for us. Color is for storytelling. Personally, being from Mississippi, I really have a strong tie to nature. So for my thesis at MICA a couple years ago, I branded what would be considered like a Southern kitschy guy's clothing store and kind of ephemera called DeSoto. DeSoto references the DeSoto National Forest, which is about 40 miles from where I grew up. It's named after Hernando de Soto, which was the Spanish explorer that found the Mississippi River. I wanted to play off of the fact that it's a pine forest and create this pattern of trees. I also love the fact that there's all of this Greek Revival antebellum architecture. This white against green, like, is so bright and contrasting. So that really started informing my palette, you know, all these greens, grays, blacks, whites. Cotton, this is where I went to college in an undergrad. This was literally next to my driveway to my house. It was fields of cotton left and right. There's something so pure about this untouched cotton in its natural environment. And that kind of made me think about clothing. You know, we as people wear clothes because we don't want to be naked. And, you know, at least we may want to be, but, you know, can't. and so having that little bit of white in a field of dirt was beautiful to me. And then there's areas like this that are just pine trees with little ponds that pop up throughout the year when we get a heavy rain pour. They're not there all the time. They're only a couple inches deep, but the reflections of the trees and the canopy mixed in with the actual canopy is just stunning to me. And then so I screen printed t-shirts with dead animals on them. I mean, who wouldn't want a dead animal on their shoulder? But I did it in a kind of sophisticated way, I think. Gray shirts with gray ink, black shirts with black ink, white shirts with white ink. So it was there. It wasn't in your face, though. And that's kind of how I see the South. We're there. We're definitely not in your face. But it's fun to, like, flash it around sometimes. I went too far. Oh, no, I didn't. I thought I accidentally clicked it twice. I also made pennants for each of the really southern states. And I have to admit, being from Mississippi, I never thought that Virginia or Maryland was the South. I'm coming around to that now. I've been here for 5 years. I can definitely see it. Granted. But I really wanted to play with this palette of gold and black and gray and white. In addition to the pennants, I made little medals, thinking about Southern culture and how prideful we are of our flags and of medals of kind of duty that we've served. And so each state had laser cut little wooden medals, and they all kept this very straightforward black, white, gray, and gold. And then note cards. What Southern gentlemen, well, rephrase that. We all should be writing note cards to people. I'm the world's worst at it. You know, I'm like the mechanic that has a broken car. I never write a single thank you card, even though I should. And I wanted to play around with the dead animals and arrows, you know, kind of the mechanisms that we use to kill these things and eat. So making it beautiful and kind of, you know, poetic at the same time, which leads me to this, Tatley. Because of my temporary tattoos were picked up by Tatley, my arrows that I drew for my thesis ended up becoming, you know, huge, and it's hitting people all across the world. And it's kind of exciting when I, like, people will buy my tattoos and I see a hashtag on Instagram of someone in California, or last year I saw someone in Moscow actually having a tattoo that I designed on them. And that's kind of an amazing thing. And, like, you know, can't forget the ladies and have some little bugs for them too. So this is kind of how I see color. I did a little experiment for myself, just as a personal thing, but also as an opportunity to explore something for Creative Mornings. For 30 days in August, I every single day took two colors, made a palette of two colors. And just something that was inspiring that day, or something that, you know, caught my eye. And then the next day, I took one of those two colors and added another color to it and made another palette for that day. And I kept doing that for 30 days. And this is what I came up with. That's it.